Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua-Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Lord, I would please like to bless this church very much. This is a beautiful church. I'd like the sermon that's about to be spoken by Aaron to fall on ears that can be heard and bring it with us all day and the rest of this week. I'd like to thank you very much for this church and all the prayer that's been sent toward me. I'm a witness to all your prayers and everything like this. I've been fighting hard, and I hope that all your prayers will be answered. In Jesus Christ's name, amen.
Amen.
All right. Well, I'm going to do things a little bit out of the ordinary. Today's study is going to be in the book of Numbers, chapter 21. It's a story about the bronze snake. And we're also going to be in the Gospel of John. I'm going to go a little bit out of order because, well, that's how we roll here. For those of you who maybe arrived a little late, you missed the excitement. One thing I've learned is that when you walk with the Lord, it's always exciting. You can't make this stuff up. Literally, we're setting up church. There's, 20, 30 people here all setting up. Five police cars show up.
No, more than
six.
Five. No, there was like 12.
We can fishtail it if we want. Ten. But anyway, we're all standing around, right? And they all come in. They got rifles, and they're all like, down. Everybody down. And there was a guy about 10 feet from me. Needless to say, I was down and I was paying attention. And for the record, I don't need any more coffee this morning. Adrenaline's good. And long story short, he was a BB pistol, but they didn't know what it was, and there was the concern of it being, a Colt. And so my dad's a retired probation officer, so I know all about the whole, prepare for the worst, right? So, but it was a little scary for all of us, because I've been down here for a long time and never had that happen before in life. So, it kind of reminds me of my walk with the Lord, though. Like he's taught me, you never know what's going to happen. And we're going to study about Moses today, and he's going to be leading his people Israel in the desert. And we're going to get to that. It's going to be cool. But let me back up a little bit, because Moses was chosen by, who was Moses chosen by to lead Israel? It wasn't Moses, I promise you that. he did not volunteer. Moses and I have a couple things in common. Number one, we're both adopted. He actually was, he was floating in the Nile. You guys know the story about that? So the Hebrews were getting, their population was getting too big. Too many people in Egypt. They were the slaves, and they didn't want them to get in power, so they started killing the babies, the male babies, right? So his mom puts Moses in a little floating basket right by Pharaoh's place. I'm not sure if that was planned or not, but anyway, he floats down, and then the Pharaoh's daughter ends up with Moses. They hire his real mom, not knowing his real, back to take care of him. That's a good deal, right? He's raised both a Hebrew and an Egyptian. And when he turns 40, he gets this, he's going out he sees his people being mistreated, and he tries to rectify the wrong with his own power, and he kills a guy. An Egyptian guy, and then he has to run for his life, right? So on his own strength, he didn't do anything, right? He didn't fix the wrong. Then the Lord sends him for 40 years in the, in another land, and what was he doing there? He's a shepherd. Now, when you're dealing with God's people, we're like sheep in his pasture, right? Anybody been around sheep before? My sister raised sheep. They're stupid. I would say that they are like, you know, the domesticated turkey and lamb and sheep. They're really close on who's dumber. Don't know, but so guess what? We're the dumb sheep of his pasture. But you know what? As we'll see today, we can be that way. We can be really dumb. But it was good experience and good training for Moses, because he's learning how to take care of dumb sheep. And soon he's going to be taking care of dumb people. And Lord's going to use him. So he spends 40 years, you know, in Egypt. Then he's outside getting as a shepherd. Now the Lord has him ready. Now, he doesn't think he's ready. In fact, do you remember it? Did he speak well? No. That's another thing we have in common. We're stutterers, he and I. I'm not kidding. You know, I can remember some of the most horrific experiences in life are public speaking or reading out in front of a group. You know, the kind where you get laughed at and stuff. And, you know, praise be the Lord, because he can, and that's just proof he can use anybody to get up and do, as long as you're doing your calling, right? That's the thing, is that you've got to be doing your calling. And that's what Moses was called to lead the people. And now he had a mouthpiece. This is another thing we have in common, the name Aaron. His brother's name was Aaron. So see how much we have in common here? So, but he didn't want the job, but the Lord said, I don't need you to be good. I just need you to do what I say. And then I'm going to be the God. I'm going to be the hero here. And I think back, and this is why I'm so glad that Steve's here today, because he's the one person I remember was here about 6 years ago, I think it is now, when I got to do this with no real training or warning. It was a Palm Sunday, and the Lord said, I woke up in the morning. Pastor Izzy had given me a heads up, and he said, I don't feel good. You might need to preach tomorrow. And I said, no, I'm just going to pray that you get well. And I fell asleep. Not kidding. He gave me scriptures. I didn't even read all the scriptures before I fell asleep. And I slept a deep sleep. I didn't like think all night, oh, what am I going to say? I was like, Lord, I'm not going to speak. That's what I'm thinking. And then I woke up in the morning, and the Lord's prepared this whole sermon for me. Now, I haven't done this before, so I'm not sure if it's just a test or if I'm actually going to be doing it. But I get there, and Pastor Z's like, are you going to do it? And I'm like, I don't know. I've not been in this situation before. Never done this before. Didn't even teach Sunday school before. Why would I do this? And the Lord said, okay, you're ready. You got no training. You're going to be totally dependent on me. I didn't mention this. This is back. I've upgraded now. I have a smartphone. But before my smartphone, I had Post-its. My staff can vouch for that. So my Post-its, I had written down all these things, this whole sermon that the Lord had just given me. I woke up in the morning. It's all right there on the back of my head. I just got to write it down. And then I come up to the front and open up. Where are we at? We're on the beach. Chance of breeze, 100%. There go my notes. Great. And but that was a lesson for me, because it showed me that I don't need to depend on me. I need to depend on God. And what I saw, this teaching that I never wanted to do, suddenly the Lord threw me into it. I was like, well, this is pretty cool. You know, and I give glory to God, because it wasn't me that did it. It was him that did it. I didn't prepare. I did prepare today, but only by the help of the Holy Spirit. You know, it's a matter of you trusting the Lord to walk where you may not be comfortable. And I know that I was called to do this, because it wasn't where I would want to be normally. And then let's see, that was my first time. And then 2 years go by, and the next time I'm coming up again on short notice, I'm like, oh, I better study my notes again here on set, a few minutes before I'm going to be giving the message. And a guy comes up and says, I want to kill myself. I've got a gun. I just need a pencil and paper so I can write a goodbye note to my mom. And then the Sunday after that, we got rained out, so new venue. And by the fourth time, I'm like, Lord, whatever. And so this morning, when the police showed up and they're pointing assault rifles at me, you know, I'm like, whatever. Been there, done that. So, so Moses is going to be used to, we're going to see him in today's story. And he starts off, you know, the Israelites had spent 400 years in slavery, brutal conditions. And then in comes Moses. And were they excited to see him as a leader? I mean, he didn't think that they were going to like him. Did they like him? No, but then God does a few miracles to earn their favor. And he's like, okay, 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 you can be the leader. And then the Lord starts doing some plagues, right? Pestilence and blah, 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 all these things, right, that devastate the land and the people. And did the Pharaoh let them go? Not with most of them. And then finally it comes to the last one. And I want you to pay special attention to this, because we're going to come back around to this again at the end of the message, okay? So this is the institution. The last plague that broke the Pharaoh's back was the killing of the firstborn male throughout the land. Person and animal. And the only way that son, first son, got spared was by the Passover. Okay, so the Passover, this is the first, it's the institution of the first Jewish Passover meal. They've got bitter herbs to remind them of the bitterness of bondage, although they will forget. And then they're going to have unleavened bread. We'll come back to this again, but pay attention. So unleavened bread, no yeast in the bread. And at the time, it's a symbol of, we don't have time for this yeast to rise. We're leaving tomorrow, all right? And then we've got this lamb. And so they each household had to get a perfect lamb, no blemishes. They had to slay it, take the blood, put it over the doorposts and the lintels into your home, and then you had to eat the entire lamb. Not raw, you could cook it. But you had to, and then you had to eat the entire lamb. No, nothing left behind, okay? And then when the angel of death came over, if you had that blood over your home, you were spared. Everybody else, all the Egyptians, including the Pharaoh's own son, the heir to the throne, dies, right? When that angel of death comes. Now, that broke the back, sort of. So now Moses is leading the people. Now, where are they heading? To the desert. We haven't gotten there yet, but they're going to the Red Sea, right? And the Lord's blessed them. They've got, not only are they leading with all of their animals and everything, they got lots of jewelry and all that. You can read more on that in yourself. But so this is all getting us going to, now, oh, wait, Pharaoh didn't quit yet. He's reneged on his idea of letting them go, right? Now he's like, wait a minute, my workforce just left. You know, this is like the first union rebellion, right? So they're trapped against the Red Sea. Chariots are coming. And what does the Lord do? Let's go, guys, on dry ground. Now, how many people? Anybody guess how many people we're talking about? At least 2 million, roughly 2 million. 2 million people across the Red Sea. And then what? And the water was just being held back. It wasn't like he just went way back. There was walls of water right on either side. And then they get through on dry ground. And then what happens? Chariots come, right? Oops, wrong time to be there. Water comes and they're washed away. Lord's protected them again. So got them out of Egypt, got them across the Red Sea. Now they're into the desert, right? Now they are heading towards, and where are they going, by the way? Going to the Promised Land, a land flowing with milk and honey. Now, I'm allergic to milk, so it's not so inviting to me. I'll take the honey part, maybe not the milk. But they're heading towards the Promised Land. Now, when they go, the Lord is, now there's a deal. Every day they get, in the morning, there's manna. Lord rains down manna from heaven. Now, manna, it means, what is it? So what was it? Well, it was this weird stuff. It was white, like coriander seed, the Bible says. And it would show up in the morning. As the dew dried, then it would be all over the ground. And so the Israelites would go, and they would harvest it. And there was plenty. There was enough for all of them to eat. In fact, sometimes they would get extra. Problem was, they were told, don't get any extra. It'll just spoil. And sure enough, are they going to test it and find out? Yep, they do. And it spoils. Except the day before the Sabbath, they could get 2 days' portion, so they didn't have to work on the Sabbath. So there was a provision, and it didn't rot on that one time. This is God. And how many people is he feeding? 2 million people in a desert. Now, I want to play a little game with you. You guys like reality shows? I like reality survival shows. Anybody watch any of those? Okay, we're gonna. So this is the scene. We are take away the water. Look down, desert. This is Survivor Desert for 2 million people. You know, one of my favorite shows is Survivor Man. Anybody seen Survivor Man? Now, I give him props for doing his own filming, but he is not an example of survival skills. You know, he usually has to get rescued, or he spends all day making this elaborate thing to collect water, and he gets one drop. And so, you know, the only reason he survives is because he only lasts for like a week. So, but these guys, now, they have a chance to go straight to the promised land. And they get to the promised land, and the Lord's been providing this manna on the ground, and he's been providing water and protecting them. And then they get to the promised land, and they send spies out, right? They go into the promised land, and what do the spies say? Good stuff or not good stuff? Well, the land is good. It's beautiful. It is a land flowing milk and honey and giants. And we don't think we can take them. Now, let me ask you a question. Who's their God? I mean, did he not just do, you know, mighty miracles to get them out of Egypt? Did he not part the waters to get them there? Has he not fed them? And now they get to the promised land and they're worried about some clumsy giants? Well, the Lord says, okay, based on your faith, you get to wander around here for how long? Anyone want to take a guess? 40 years. 40 years in a desert. Now, that brings us to today, okay? Now, if you've got your Bibles with you, you know what I wanted to just show? Well, we'll get there. All right, so open your book to Numbers. Numbers 21. No post-it notes to fly away. All right, and we're going to be in verse 4, okay? They traveled from Mount Hor along the route to the Red Sea to go around Edom. But the people grew impatient on the way. They spoke against God and against Moses and said, "Why have you brought us out of Egypt to die in the desert? There is no bread, there is no water, and we detest this miserable food." Let me stop there for a second. I just told you, how long have they been in the desert? 40 years. And now they're worried about it? Like, now there's no food and no water? And note that it doesn't actually say that there's no food. It says that we detest this miserable food. It sounds like they're grumbling. And if you read before this, there's a whole lot more grumbling. They have an attitude of grumbling, matter of fact. So let's move on. Then the Lord sent venomous snakes among them. They bit the people, and many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, "We sinned when we spoke against the Lord and against you. Pray that the Lord will take the snakes away from us." So Moses prayed for the people. The Lord said to Moses, "Make a snake and put it on a pole, and anyone who is bitten can look at it and live." So Moses made a bronze snake and put it on a pole, and when anyone was bitten by a snake and looked at the bronze snake, he lived. All right, that brings me to my first prop. Recognize this? And for my veterinary friends in the audience, this is the story that tells us, this is where our modern symbol of medicine and healing comes from. Now, interesting, when I did some research, people never want to give credit where credit is due. And so there was a Greek physician, lived, by the way, after this event, that became kind of mythical and legendary, and so that's where Rod of Asclepius, I think was his name, and so a lot of people would credit him, okay? And then there's the other version of this staff with a snake on it is one with the kind of two snakes going up, and then it has some wings on the top. That's actually from Hermes. And I think that largely that was a misunderstanding of Greek mythology, because it came very popular in the United States, but nowhere else. So leave it to us. But I'm going to go with the original version, the one that happened first, the one with a real God, not a mythical God. Let's stick to that one. Well, let me go. This is cool stuff because So on the when you first look at it, okay, the people were complaining because they didn't have food or water. And, you know, I don't know, if you're honest with yourself, if I'm honest with myself, I complain to God. Anybody complain about, say, you know what, this sucks, I don't like what's going on right now? I do. And then when I look back at this and I realize these guys were wandering in the desert for 40 years and the Lord took care of them every day. Every day, manna showed up and fed them. I'm older than 40 years, so that means the Lord's been putting up with me and my complaints for a lot longer. I'm just glad that we live in Hawaii where we don't have snakes, because then I'd have to be worried about getting bit by the snake. But there's something deeper here. You know, there's something that this, on the surface, you go, okay, well, this is about provisions and you know, and meeting my daily needs. And the Lord certainly did that. But there is something deeper, because Jesus, this is really about Jesus. And I'm going to show that to you. And it comes from good authority, because it's from Jesus himself that it talks about this. But in life, we've all been bitten by that same by a serpent called sin. And starting with Adam and Eve back in the garden, and Moses himself. Moses was actually leading the people to the promised land. Did he get to go there? Anybody know? Nope. He disobeyed God not far from the end, and he got to see the promised land, but he never got to take them in. Interesting, God let one of the spies who went in, there were two spies out of 12, two of them came back and said, the land's good, there's giants, who cares, we got you, God. And the rest went, no, we can't take them, they're big, we're small people. So Joshua was one of those spies. He took over Moses' spot, and he got to take him into the promised land. Cool stuff, huh? He had faith. He got to take the... And by the way, Joshua is a contraction for Jesus, not by coincidence. So in our life, we're battling with sin just like Adam did, just like Moses did, and we've all been bitten by... We're in the desert of life. And we need spiritual food, we need spiritual water, we need protection, and we need these guys. Now, when they got bit, now those before Moses prayed, they didn't have a solution. But after people started dying, there was a solution, right? What did they have to do? If they got bit, they had to look at the standard that was raised. And what happened if you didn't? Doesn't actually say, but you would guess, right? If you don't look, you die. Doesn't take long to convince you, you know, I better look, right? Because I saw what already happened to those that don't. So this is a result. So that whole lifting up the serpent on, that's who got lifted up on the cross? Jesus. Jesus got lifted up on the cross, and he was the one that lived the perfect life and had the, you know, and he would be that perfect sacrifice. He's the one that took the sin, and he's the one that we look to. Now, tell you, Jesus said that himself. So let's turn to the Gospel of John. I'll show you, this is good stuff. John chapter 3. Now this is a story about Nicodemus. You guys remember Nicodemus? Nicodemus, Nicodemus was a religious guy. In fact, he came to Jesus at night, as we'll see, because he didn't want the Jewish people, his peers, to know what he was doing, because Jesus wasn't really popular with the religious guys. He was with the commoners, but not with the religious guys, because he was challenging the authority. Now, let's go ahead and let's read here. It's Gospel of John 3, verse 1. Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, Rabbi, we know you're a teacher who has come from God. No one could perform the miraculous signs you were doing if God were not with him. In reply, Jesus declared, I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again. How can a man be born when he is old? Nicodemus asked. Surely he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb. Jesus answered, I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sounds, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. How can this be? Nicodemus asked. You are Israel's teacher, Jesus said, and you do not understand these things? I tell you the truth. We speak of what we know, and we testify to what we have seen. But still you people have not accepted our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things, and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has ever come from heaven. No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. And that, by the way, is Jesus' self-title, right? He's the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake and the serpent. Did you catch that? So the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. Now, this is the prelude to one of my favorite verses in the whole Bible. This is, I think, for a lot of people. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. All right. Okay, we're in the desert. We've got, this is Jesus' protection from death, right? You lift him up on the cross, you've been bitten by sin, you look to him, you get saved. Okay, now let's look at some refreshing water. If you're in a desert, you better have some water, right? Okay, let's go a little bit further to John chapter 4. Verse 4. This is about the Samaritan woman at the well. I want you to notice, actually it says in here, but Samaritans were outcasts. And you'll note if you look at Jesus' life, he spent a lot of time with outcasts. Thank goodness for that. Because I don't know about you, but I'm an outcast. And happily so, because I know the Lord cares about me too. All right. So now this is Jesus with the Samaritan woman. Okay. Now he had to go through Samaria. It was like he didn't have to, but he had to because God had an appointment for him. So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near a plot of ground Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about the sixth hour or noon. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, he said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" His disciples had gone into town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him, and he would give you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his flocks and herds?" Jesus said, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." All right. So we got our protection. We got our water. One more survival thing. What do you need in the water in the wild to live? Food. All right. Move a little. Let's go to John 6. And this is the time I'll go have you guys. We're going to go ahead and pass out communion. We'll get that in just a minute. But meanwhile, we're going to read John 6. Now, just a little perspective. Jesus has just fed the 5,000 people, okay? Mighty miracle, okay? And now here's Jesus right after that. When they found him on the other side of the lake, they asked him, "Rabbi, when did you get here?" Jesus answered, "I tell you the truth, you were looking for me not because you saw miraculous signs, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. On him, the Father has placed his seal of approval." Then they asked him, "What must we do to do the works God requires?" Jesus answered, "The work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent. So they asked him, what miraculous sign will you give us that we may see it and believe you? Now, wait a minute. Did he just feed 5,000 people? Do they want another miracle? These guys have a hard heart. What will you do? Our forefathers ate manna in the desert, as it is written. He gave them bread from heaven to eat. Jesus said to them, I tell you, it's not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Sir, they said, from now on give us this bread. Jesus declared, pay attention, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never go hungry, and he who believes in me will never be thirsty. But as I told you, you have seen me and you still do not believe. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven not to do my will, but to do the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all that he has given me, but raise them up at the last day. For my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. At this the Jews began to grumble about him, because he said, I am the bread that comes down from heaven. They said, is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose mother and father we know? How could he say I came down from heaven? Okay, so Joseph was his earthly dad. Who was his real dad? Man upstairs, God. That was actually his real dad. Joseph was more of a stepfather. All right, so how can he say I came down from heaven? Stop grumbling among yourselves. Ah, here's that grumbling again. Sound familiar? Sound like some Israelites in the desert, maybe? All right. Jesus answered, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day. Lost my place. It is written in the prophets, they will all be taught by God. Everyone who listens to the Father and learns from him comes to me. No one has seen the Father except the one who is from God. Only he has seen the Father. I tell you the truth, he who believes has everlasting life. I am the bread of life. Your forefathers ate manna in the desert, yet they died. But here is the bread that comes down from heaven, which a man may eat and not die. I am the living bread that comes down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give, which will give life of the give for the life of the world. Then the Jews began to argue sharply among themselves. How can this man give us his flesh to eat? Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is real food and my blood is real drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in him. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so the one who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven. Your fathers ate manna and died, but he who feeds on this bread will live forever. I'm going to read a little bit further, and we'll come back to this, because I want you to watch the reaction of the people after hearing this. He said this while teaching in the synagogues at Capernaum. On hearing this, many of the disciples said, this is a hard teaching. Who can accept it? Aware that his disciples were grumbling about this, Jesus said to them, does this offend you? What if you see the Son of Man ascend to where he was before? The Spirit gives life, the flesh counts for nothing. The words I have spoken to you are spirit, and they are life. Yet there are some of you who do not believe. For Jesus had known from the beginning which of them did not believe and who would betray them. He went on to say, this is why I told you no one can come to him unless the Father has enabled him. From this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him. I'll read on a little bit further, but that's pretty heartbreaking, yeah? Oof. They followed. They were following him, and all of a sudden, this is too much. We'll come back to that. Pay attention to this last bit. This is good stuff. You do not want to leave me too, do you? Jesus asked the 12 disciples. Simon Peter answered him. I like this. Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We believe and know that you are the Holy One of God. It's a harsh thing, you know. He's talking about eating his flesh and drinking his blood. It's kind of a graphic thing. But Jesus was looking for true followers. He wasn't looking for somebody to show up and be one of the 5,000 that got fed and go, a little bit for me, thanks very much. Remember what Jesus said? He said, if you want to be my disciple, you need to do a couple things. You need to deny yourself, pick up your what? Cross and follow me. Inviting, isn't it? I mean, it is if you know what you're doing it for, but to deny yourself your own interest and to follow Jesus wearing a cross on your back, that's not so inviting, but worth it. See, Jesus was looking, he's the true bread that came down from heaven. We'll come back to that in just a second, but he's looking for true followers. He wants to know who's really with him and who's just out for a free lunch. And he's not looking for somebody that's just going to come on Sunday morning, spend an hour with him, and then the rest of the time it's all theirs. And I've lived that. I've been there. I understand that. But that's not the eternal life that you get. Remember back when that Passover meal? Remember that? You've got the bitter herbs. Okay, well, we can all relate to bitterness in our lives. Now you've got the yeast, the unleavened bread, right? Now in that moment, it's kind of led to believe that it's about getting this bread ready to eat. So you got to eat and go, right? But yeast in the Bible is used to represent sin. And when Jesus is talking about he's the bread of life. By the way, where was Jesus born? The house, Bethlehem, the house of bread. So let me get this right. The bread of life, born in the house of bread, could this be Jesus? It is Jesus. He is the bread of life. And he was without sin. He's that bread, the unleavened bread, like no sin. He didn't have any sin. That's what made him the perfect sacrifice. And remember when John the Baptist saw him, he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God, that takes away the sins of the world." Okay, let's go back to that Passover meal. You remember, they what did they have to do? They had to take a perfect lamb, they had to slay it, and they had to take the blood and put it over the doorpost. That was the protection. That was a covering that would protect them from the angel of death. Okay? And so they've got this, and then they had to eat the whole lamb. Does that sound familiar? Jesus is talking about, you got to eat my flesh. You got to drink my blood. You want a part of me. You want to follow me. You got to take it's a whole package deal. I'm not looking for somebody who's not gonna be a true disciple. Who's not gonna take it all in. In this story of the bronze serpent, God provided for them. He provided food and water, and he provided a way for them. Now some would say, I don't want that way. And they were grumbling, right? They were like, I don't want this food anymore. But he was giving them enough to get by. He's given us a way of escape, and that's his son Jesus. You know, when we talk about, so at that Passover lamb, it spared the firstborn male. What did God have to give up when he went for his son? He gave up his son, ironically, right? To save all of us, he gave his firstborn male. But he did that out of love because he loves us and he saves us. But some would say, well, I don't want that way to eternal life. I want to make my own way. And God gives each of us a choice. We can choose to follow him and take the manna and the water and the saving, you know, we've got this Savior on a cross to save us from that bite called sin that separates us from ever for God. We got to take that though. That's God's provision. The choice is just like the Israelites, we got to choose, do we take it or do we not take it? Cool, huh? I hope that hits you, because when I think about that, I think of what God did for me. You know, God stepped out of his comfort zone. Jesus went through, you know, hell on earth, but he did it out of love. All we have to do is look at him and believe. And not like, oh yeah, I know Jesus. I know, you know, I know his name. Satan knows his name. Not following him though. So you've got to, each of us, we have to decide, are we going to take God's provision and go to eternal life? Or are we going to try to go our own way? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, the life. Not a way, not a truth, not a life. The way, the one and only way. The rest falls onto us. We get to make that personal decision about what we want to do with it. Okay, so let's say that you, so if you believe in Jesus and he's, and you've trusted him with eternity, do you need to worry about your daily bread? Nope. I think he's got that covered. So for your time on this earth, you can trust him. If you can trust him for eternity, surely you can trust him for your daily bread. But we just need to learn how to be content and maybe grumble a little less. All right, we're going to do communion. This is a good way to end today. We've got our unleavened matzah cracker. Jesus started this the night before he was going to the cross. Did he know he was going to get betrayed? Did he know he was going to die? He sure did, and he went anyway. And this, he said, this is my body broken for you. No yeast in it, no sin. He was the perfect sacrifice. Let's take this in remembrance. Oh, actually, sorry, before you do that, if you haven't got it in your mouth already, that's okay, but take a moment. We're supposed to, when we remember this, we're supposed to clear our conscience, and we're not supposed to come to him. If we're going to remember what he did on the cross, we better remember how forgiving he was to us. So why don't you take a minute and think about, do you have any unforgiveness in your heart towards somebody else? Because remember the parable about the person with many talents, the landlord. God has a generous heart. You can't outgive God. He's always, and just taking care of our sins, by the way. We're not capable of, that's a debt we could never pay, but God pays it. So if he can be forgiving with us, should we not be forgiving for our neighbor and our friend and our family members? So I want you to take a minute. I just want some time with you and God and just lay it at his feet and take away, let that bitterness go away. We don't need any bitterness. We want to get that refreshing time with Christ, and it'll lighten your load if you have a heart of forgiveness. Let it go. So just take a moment and let's just pray individually, okay? Okay. All right, guys, let's partake of Jesus' body. This is not his literal body. This is a reminder of his body broken for us. Jesus is smart. He's going to follow the cracker with the juice. Now, after he took the bread and we ate the bread, now this is representative of Jesus' blood. And just like that perfect lamb that they took the blood and they painted it over, this represents the blood that was shed so that he could get into our hearts. That symbolically, you know, we got blood over our hearts if we just let him in. He wants to fellowship with us. And he shed that blood. It was a high price. Sometimes people say, you know what, it's too easy, it's too free. You know, it for who is the question, right? Who paid the price? It's not me, it's Jesus. All right, let's remember Jesus' blood washed for us, shed for us. Praise God. We get to declare we're righteous before God, not because of what we did, but because of what Jesus did. Now, we're gonna end in prayer this morning. Thank you for everyone that's here today. But I just pray that you would leave here changed. I pray that you would walk tight with Jesus. I pray that you would have forgiveness for your neighbors, love for your neighbors, just like Jesus had for you, Father has for you. Didn't necessarily plan this, but I just want to take a moment. I remember when I first made a commitment to Jesus, I was at a camp, and all of my life up to that point, I've been trying to be a good kid and hoping that if I was like good enough, I'd make the cut. and I'd get into heaven. What I didn't realize was that that was a futile effort. The perfection wasn't within my grasp already at that point. And I remember there was an invitation to come forward and declare, I'm going to follow Jesus now. And I remember that was another dizzy point in my life was, but Jesus said, if you declare me before men, I will declare you before my Father. So I want to give an invitation. If there's anybody here that does not wants to surrender to Jesus or make a recommitment to Jesus, I want to ask you to come forward right now. And I know it's a group and all of that, but I'm just going to give an opportunity. You know, Jesus gave lots of opportunities for people to follow him. I just want to give anybody an opportunity. So is there anybody here that wants to profess a faith in Jesus? Okay. Well, we're going to have a time for prayer afterwards, but let's just pray the Lord this morning. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you that it's living and alive. I thank you that, Father, that you would send your firstborn as living water, as bread of life, as that serpent on the cross that we could look to for salvation. And Lord, I pray that you would use us as a springboard now to encourage us in our walk with you. May we grow walk ever closer to you. May we serve you more and more. We pick up that cross willingly and follow you. And Lord, may we share that good news with those around us. We ask that now in Jesus. Everybody said, amen. Amen. All right. God bless.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.